And now, Roma Wines, R-O-M-A, made in California for enjoyment throughout the world, Roma Wines present Suspense.
Tonight, Roma Wines bring you Mr. Hume Cronin as star of Blue Eyes, a suspense play produced, edited, and directed for Roma Wines by William Spear.
Suspense, radio's outstanding theater of thrills, is presented for your enjoyment by Roma Wines. That's R-O-M-A, Roma Wines, those excellent California wines that can add so much pleasantness to the way you live, to your happiness in entertaining guests, to your enjoyment of everyday meals. Yes, right now, a glass full would be very pleasant, as Roma Wines bring you Hume Cronin in a remarkable tale of
suspense.
Today began just like any other day. I got to bed early last night because I had to go over the accounts with Mr. Bevins. When you go over the accounts with old Hawkshaw, you've got to be in tip-top shape. Well, I dressed myself rather carefully this morning. I put on the necktie with the little flowers on it, the blue and red one. Jane said she liked it. Told me it matched my eyes. Made them look bluer. I went down to breakfast. My wife, Laura, was having her coffee.
Good morning, Oliver.
Good morning, dear.
I'll have to warm your coffee. Here's the paper.
Thanks.
Oliver, must you wear that tie?
Hmm?
That frightful necktie. It's not at all becoming.
Well, matches my suit.
It's a perfectly dreadful shade. Makes you look like a rube.
I like it.
Well, I don't. And I wish you wouldn't wear it. Oliver, aren't you listening to me?
Oh, sure, sure. I was reading.
Oh. Well, don't let my conversation disturb you.
That's all right.
Oliver!
What's wrong now?
Oliver, I don't know what's gotten into you lately. You forget things. You scarcely seem to hear a word I say. Aren't you feeling well?
I feel fine. Why shouldn't I?
Well, you look a bit drawn. I believe I'd better make an appointment for you with Dr. Thacker.
Look, Laura, there's nothing the matter with me. I better get going now. I'll be late.
But you haven't finished your breakfast.
Well, that's all I want. I'm not very hungry. Where's my briefcase?
On the hall table. Oliver, are you sure you're not ill? You look positively hollow-eyed.
I never felt better in my life.
Well.
See you tonight, dear. Goodbye.
Oliver.
Yes?
I hope you'll all... Oh, nothing. Goodbye.
Laura was like that, a chronic worrier. She seemed to take delight in fretting about things that wouldn't even occur to the average person. Imagine me not feeling well. Why, I've never had a sick day in my life. There on the trellis was my prize rose bush. Climbing talisman, they call it. Suddenly, I was thinking of Jane. Perhaps if I put a rosebud in my buttonhole, Jane would notice. She'd say something about how the scent matched her perfume, and maybe we'd talk about roses. And I could impress her, because I know quite a lot about roses. I was just about to pick one of the buds.
Well, well, well. Good morning, Mr. Littlefield. Good morning. Two letters for you today.
Good morning, Mr. Crowley.
Well, I see you're doing a little gardening, hmm?
Oh, no. I was just sort of looking the garden over.
Well, it's a mighty fine garden you got there, Mr. Littlefield. Worked pretty hard on it, I suppose.
Yes, I've given it my fair share of time.
Oh, yes. A little too much, maybe, hmm?
I beg your pardon?
Well, it pays to be on the safe side, Mr. Littlefield. Now, of course, it ain't none of my business, but it seems to me that you're getting to look a little peaked. You better go easy.
Yes. Well,
son, you know.
Good morning, Mr. Crowley.
Yes, sir. Good morning to you, sir. I gotta get going anyway.
It was the second time. The second time I'd heard it, and the day was hardly more than an hour old. First Laura, and now the postman. I felt all right. I felt swell. I thought of the rosebud again. I bent down, snipped off a bud from the bush. Had to take the red cross pin out of my lapel to get the rose in, but I didn't mind taking the time. After all, 1 minute more or less never harmed anyone. I didn't know then how precious a minute can be. I glanced at my watch, 8:23. I had to run part of the way to the station. I arrived out of breath, panting, perspiring a bit, but I made it. Steve and Joe helped me aboard.
Come on.
Oliver, you ought to get an earlier start in the morning.
I was delayed at the house.
Boy, listen to old Ollie Wheeze. And you're the guy who used to be a track star in high school. Where's the old wind, Ollie?
Oh, I'm all right. Just a second now.
Now, seriously, Oliver, it's dangerous business for a man of your age to be running around that way.
Man of my age? Listen to him. You'd think I was 80.
Say, know what you need? Maxidrine. Pep you up, make you feel like a million.
I tell you, there's nothing wrong with me.
I got two or three here with me. A little box. A pocket here somewhere. Ah, here we are. Let me make a little present. Non-habit forming, you know.
Maxidrine? What do I want with Maxidrine?
You keep them in your pocket. Take a half of one with some water when you get that sagged out feeling, you know? Pep you up like a million. Make a new man out of you.
It's getting to be just like a club. All you had to do to get a membership was to smile at me and say, Mr. Littlefield, you look a little sick. Mr. Littlefield, you look a little peaked. Mr. Littlefield, why don't you just find some nice quiet corner and go and curl up and die, Mr. Littlefield? It was 9 o'clock when I got to the office. I noticed a lumpy feeling in my solar plexus. Right here, a little on the left by my heart. It was just indigestion, of course. I got my accounts together and I went into Mr. Bevan's outer office. There was Jane at her desk. She looked lovely this morning. Sunlight coming through the Venetian blinds seemed to blend with her blonde hair. All at once, I wondered why I'd ever married Laura. Sunlight never did anything to her hair. Jane was busy and didn't see me come in. I coughed. Lightly.
Oh, Mr. Littlefield, good morning.
Good morning, Jane.
I heard you cough. Do you have a cold?
No. No, I haven't a cold. I never felt better in my life.
Well, I'm sorry, Mr. Littlefield.
Oh,
I just thought...
Forgive me, Jane. I didn't mean to snap at you. I guess I'm a little jumpy this morning.
Well, I can understand your being jumpy. Mr. Bevins can certainly be an old bear if he finds a mistake in the books.
He certainly can.
But I wouldn't worry. You're well-dressed for the occasion. That rose in your lapel should appeal to his more pleasant side. That is, if he has a more pleasant side.
Just happened to notice the bud in one of the bushes in the garden this morning. I don't know why I wore it.
It looks very nice.
Thank you. It's a climbing talisman. You know anything about roses?
No, I'm afraid not. They're my favorite flower, though.
I grow them as a hobby. I had some exhibited once.
Oh, you must be quite a gardener.
Oh, no, I'm not really. You see, there isn't a lot to growing a good rose. You just have to watch your soil carefully. Irrigate, of course.
Uh-huh.
And roses take a lot of spraying, too.
Oh, I see.
And let me tell you, if you intend to exhibit your flowers, there mustn't be any evidence of insect damage. Mm-hmm. You see, a rose is judged first by its form and color, then substance, then...
Excuse me.
Oh, of course.
Yes, sir.
Have you seen Littlefield?
Why, yes, sir, he...
Why in the name of heaven has he come in here? Why doesn't he know he has a 9 o'clock appointment with me?
Well, Mr. Bevins, Mr. Littlefield has been waiting for you in the outer office. You didn't call, sir,
and... Is it necessary for me to call my employees after I've made a specific appointment?
Well, I'm sorry, Mr. Bevins. I'm sure that Mr. Littlefield would...
Littlefield's a fool. Have him come in here right away.
Yes, sir. Mr. Littlefield,
it's all right.
I just...
It's all right, Jane. I'll go right in. I walked toward the door. I could feel that lump inside of me getting bigger, almost choking. What right did Bevins have to say such things about me? And in front of Jane? I reached for the door handle and turned it.
Well, Littlefield, what are you standing there for? Come in. Sit down. Littlefield, I believe you're aware of my sentiments regarding punctuality. I expect my employees to be on time. In fact, I demand that they do.
Well, you see, Mr. Bevins,
Never mind. We'll discuss the matter at a later date. Right now, I want to see the vouchers. Last month's.
Yes, sir. Right here.
Littlefield, these are the May vouchers.
Oh. So they are. I'm sorry, Mr. Bevins. Here.
Oh. Now, let me see the audit on these.
Yes, sir.
Not the sales slips, Littlefield. The audit.
Oh.
What the devil's wrong with you, man?
What?
A person would think you are completely addled.
Addled? Well, I'm not addled. And I'm not a fool, either. You had no right to call me that, you understand?
Littlefield, I think you must be ill.
No. No, I'm not ill. Don't say I'm ill, because I never felt better in my life. All that's wrong with me, Mr. Bevins, is that I'm mad.
Yes, that's the word for it. I think you are mad. Completely mad.
That's not what I mean either, Mr. Bevins. I'm perfectly all right, except that I'm not going to sit here and listen to you calling me names. No, sir. I've got 17 years' worth of temper stored up right here, and I'm warning you, Mr. Bevins, I'd like to tell you just what I think of you.
Get out of this office, Littlefield. If there's one thing I will not tolerate, it's insubordination.
All right, Mr. Bevins, all right. So I'm insubordinate. And it may surprise you to know that I've wanted to be insubordinate for 17 long years.
See, here, young...
17 years, yeah. I've worked for you, and what thanks have I ever had for it? $2 raises, and listening to you about...
Littlefield, get out! You're fired.
I know. Sure, I'm fired. But that's all you can do to me, Mr. Bevins. All you can do is fire me. Why didn't you fire me a long time ago? So there I was. Out of a job. What was the next step? I couldn't go home in the middle of the day. Well, I could, but you don't know Laura. Never would have been able to explain it to her. She wouldn't have understood. She never understood anything. With her, it was payday, the bridge club, a new hat for Easter. Everything suburban, everything in a rut, always in a rut. Oh, I went back and sat in my office to think. After a little while, I got up and went to the water cooler, pulled my handkerchief out to wipe off my hands, and something fell out of my pocket. It was that little pill box. I opened it. There were 3.5 of those Maxidrines in it. I swallowed them all. I sat down, and in a little I began to feel clear in my mind. My life with this awful, deadly grind, because I was married to Laura. She was the cause of all my unhappiness. The cause of my failure, the reason for my losing my job. Something would have to be done about Laura. Why not eliminate the cause? That was it. Eliminate the cause and you have the situation licked. Eliminate the cause. Suddenly my mind was made up. I must kill Laura.
For Suspense, Roma Wines are bringing you Hume Cronin in Blue Eyes by Charles Smith and Lewis Reed. Roma Wines' presentation tonight in radio's outstanding theater of thrills, Suspense.
Between the acts of Suspense, this is Ken Niles for Roma Wines. Every great artist creates many fine paintings, but there is usually one picture in which the artist's talents combine magnificently to produce a masterpiece. It is frequently so with wines. Long famed for the excellence of Roma wines, Roma, America's greatest vintner, has created a limited bottling of outstanding character. Grand estate wines, each a masterpiece of fine winemaking. Yes, grand estate wines by Roma possess all the qualities of wine greatness. Brilliant clarity, full fragrance, and soft, rich taste. For Roma vintners, with infinite patience and age-old skill, have captured, from choicest grapes, the ultimate in wine goodness. That is why discriminating wine users everywhere recognize grand estate wines as the crowning achievement of vintner skill. Tomorrow, enjoy the delightful experience awaiting you in grand estate California wines. For gracious hospitality before dinner, serve your guests Grand Estate Medium Sherry. For smart afternoon or evening entertaining, delight everyone with Grand Estate Ruby Port or Golden Muscatel. Remember the name, Grand Estate Wines by Roma. Each a taste masterpiece.
And now, Roma Wines bring back to our Hollywood soundstage Hume Cronin, who has Oliver Littlefield in Blue Eyes, continues a narrative well calculated to keep you in suspense.
Murder's a tough proposition. Takes a lot of thought. Mustn't be messy or violent. It's got to be quick and effective. Or else a guy stands a chance of getting caught. How to do this thing? How to do it without a slip? Suddenly, I had it. Laura took some medicine every night at bedtime. 2 tablespoons of powder that Dr. Thacker had prescribed for her and a glass of warm milk. If I were to get some poison that looked like that powder and substitute... Yes. That was perfect. I couldn't miss. Quick and effective. Three o'clock. I walked up the steps of the public library and went in.
Yes, sir. Can I help you?
I'd like to see some books on...
Yes?
I just wanted to look over something on roses.
Oh, that's horticulture, section 5, just across the aisle.
Oh, yes. Horticulture, of course. Thank you. I took a book from the shelf, thumbed a few pages, and then finally decided to risk a quick glance in the direction of the librarian, see if she was still watching me. The desk was empty. She'd left it. Then I saw where she was, at the other end of the library, stacking books in a handcar. Here was my chance. I could slip across to the science alcove without her seeing. I went to the section marked Science, Medicine. Looked in the card index file under P. Pharmacology. Here it is. Pharmacology and Therapeutics by Walter A. Bastido, Ph.G., M.D. Someday I'm going to look up those initials and find out what they mean. I found the book. The index said, look under hydrocyanate acid and cyanate. And there it was. Cyanate, used as intensifier in photographic development. 2.5 grains of this cyanate is reckoned to be a lethal dose. I could buy the stuff in a photographic store. 2.5 grains. Fatal.
Pardon me, sir.
Oh, yes?
I'd like to put these books away if I may. Oh, you're the gentleman who was looking for books on roses.
Yes, I was.
Well, I'm afraid you're in the wrong department, sir. I told you a moment ago you'll find everything on roses. Oh, it was clumsy of me. I'm terribly sorry, sir.
Oh, it's all right. It's my fault. I was in the way.
Oh, you dropped your book. Here.
Thank you.
What? Well, this isn't a book on roses at all. It's pharmacology.
Oh, well, what do you know about that? I must have picked up the wrong book somewhere.
Yes, you must have.
She stared at me as I put the book back on the shelf. I turned and walked away. I could feel her eyes following me through the door. I was conscious of that lump under my heart again. I felt heavy and hard like a rock. And there was a dryness in my throat, too. I swallowed a few times to get rid of it. At 4th and Sutter, there's a photographic supply place.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon. I'd like some cyanate, please.
Oh, how much do you want, sir?
Oh, enough to treat some negatives with. Quite a few negatives.
Yeah, about 2 pounds?
Yes, I think that'll be fine.
Well, I'll wait for you. What kind of camera have you been using?
What? Oh, I have a Brownie camera.
Brownie, eh? Yeah. A lot of people are going back to them since the war. You can take good pictures with a box camera if you use it right. You know what they say. It's not the camera, but the man behind the camera that makes the picture.
Yes.
What size negative do you shoot with it?
Negatives? Well, as far as negatives go,
Three and a quarter, probably. That's what most Brownies take.
Yes, that's the size. I wasn't going to be able to keep this up much longer. I was bound to make a slip sooner or later. Couldn't say I was in a hurry. He might get suspicious. A man buying poison shouldn't ever be in a hurry. Why was he taking so long? I could feel perspiration on my forehead, cold and damp. The room began to look lopsided. Everything seemed to be swaying. Grip the counter with both hands. Grip it tightly. Now smile.
Here you are, sir. That'd be 57 cents.
Yes, here.
Thank you. Just a minute. Mister.
I heard him shout after me, but I kept right on walking, faster. So a photographic studio was just like a drugstore after all. If you bought poison, you had to sign for it. Well, I wasn't going to. No, sir, I wasn't going to. I ducked around the corner.
Hey, officer, you see a fellow just come out of here?
What fellow?
Gray suit, blue tie, rose in the buttonhole.
No.
He's gone. Now, what do you make of that? The guy gives me a 20 instead of a 1 and disappears. Well, I can do business like that all day long. I won't forget that, gent. No, sir.
I arrived home at 6:30. Laura wasn't there. The table wasn't set. Well, she was probably late shopping. I went upstairs and found the bottle in the medicine chest. The cyanate matched the powder in the bottle perfectly. She'd never be able to tell the difference. I poured half the bottle's contents into the sink, marked with my finger the level of the medicine, and then refilled the bottle with cyanate up to the mark and shook it so as to mix it thoroughly. I emptied the rest of the poison in the sink, and I let the water run for a minute. There. It was done. Everything accomplished. And very neatly, too. All I had to do now was wait. I glanced at the bedroom door. It was closed. All the doors on the second floor were closed. That's another thing. That's another thing I hated about Laura. So precise about her housekeeping. Everything in its place. Even to closing doors when a room wasn't in use. I went back downstairs and I tried to light a cigarette. My hands were beginning to shake. Nerves again. I took a book from the table by the sofa. Tried to read. Then I realized what I was reading. Funny I should have picked up that book. Memory album of Oliver and Laura Littlefield. And a dance program tied in pink ribbon. Homecoming Dance, Indiana University, 1928. First anniversary. Oliver and Laura Littlefield celebrating their first anniversary, July the 12th, 1929. They invite you to an informal tea. Suddenly, I was lonesome for Laura. I missed her. Where was she? Why was she so late? I wanted to hear her voice. Even if she nagged me, it didn't really matter. I wanted to hear her say something. I thought back over the events of that day. I thought of my married life with Laura. Hadn't been as bad as I let myself believe. Hadn't been bad at all. Laura loved me. She did. She did love me, and I loved her. I must have been crazy to even think of killing her. What would I ever do without her? I leaped to my feet, and I ran up the stairs to the medicine chest. I poured the cyanate down the drain, all of it. Washed out the sink with my hand to be sure that the last bit of the poison was gone. After that, I was calmer again. I guess I'd come to my senses. I thought of the blue tie I was wearing, the one Laura didn't like. I changed that before dinner. I opened the door of the bedroom and... Then I saw, sprawled on the bed, her face distorted in pain. I went to the bed and I shook her. Laura! Laura! She didn't move. She was cold, terribly cold. Hello? Hello, Dr. Thacker? Doctor, this is Oliver Littlefield. Can you come over right away? Something's happened to my wife. I think she's dead.
I'm afraid you were right, Mr. Littlefield.
She's...
This glass she drank from, it's poison.
But why? Why?
I'm afraid, sir, it looks like suicide.
Suicide? She wouldn't do that. She had no reason.
She had a reason, Mr. Littlefield. Your wife was dying of an incurable disease.
But that's not true. She would have told me.
She wanted to keep it from you. Those were her wishes. I'm sorry, Mr. Littlefield.
Without saying anything more, he left the room. I sat there staring at Laura. My mind was a blank. I don't know how long it was until Dr. Thacker came back.
Mr. Littlefield.
What is it?
This, bottle.
Huh? Well, that's the medicine you prescribed for my wife.
I think not.
Of course it is. Why, what are you talking about?
I didn't prescribe cyanide.
Well,
It seems that I may be obliged to revise my diagnosis of your wife's death.
I don't understand.
Well, really, Mr. Littlefield, isn't it quite obvious? Your wife's death was caused by a lethal dosage of cyanide. Her medicine bottle was filled with cyanate. The odor is still there.
Yes, but I can explain that. You see, there wasn't a bit of it left. I threw it all away. She must have bought some herself.
I hardly think she'd fill her medicine bottle with poison if she intended to commit suicide.
Now, wait a minute. You've got to listen to me. I didn't do it. I didn't do it, if that's what you're thinking. Dr. Thacker, you've known me for a long time. You can take my word for
it. Hello, operator. Get me the police.
You see, it started with that blue tie. It made my eyes look bluer. Everybody told me I was sick. I started to feel sick.
Yes, that's right. This is an emergency.
Then the Rosebud and Mr. Bevins and the Maxidrine. I didn't know what I was doing for a while.
Hello, this is Dr. Thacker.
Doctor,
you'd better send someone to 6931 Claiborne right away.
You know, people can drive you out of your mind if they keep saying the same thing to you over and over again.
I beg pardon?
You've got to listen. You've got to listen. It was the blue tie. Laura started it. She said I was hollow-eyed.
No, it looks like homicide.
It all happened in 12 short hours. But since then, the hours have been long, endless eternity. How long will I have to wait? How long until they file out of that room and tell me what I already know?
The coroner's jury find that Laura Littlefield met her death by poisoning. It's recommended that her husband, Oliver Littlefield, be held to answer.
I can hear it now. There's no other verdict. The testimony of the librarian, the clerk at the photographic store, the doctor. Powerful evidence that lies. Damning evidence that... That'll send Oliver Littlefield to the electric chair.
Mr. Littlefield, it's all over.
I knew it. I knew what you would find.
The coroner's jury found the testimony of the librarian, the clerk, and the rest convincing.
Undeniable.
And, of course, the presence of the glass of poison at your wife's bedside was confusing. Undoubtedly, she had intended to commit suicide. But, of course, we know now that she didn't.
When'll I be arrested?
That is a matter for the police. If they decide to prosecute, of course, under the circumstances...
Circumstantial evidence. I didn't murder my wife! I didn't! I didn't!
Of course not, Mr. Littlefield. The autopsy settled that. Not a single trace of poison in the body. She died as a result of her illness.
No poison?
No poison, and lucky for you, Mr. Littlefield. Because if she'd committed suicide as she planned, just how would you have been able to prove your innocence, Mr. Littlefield? Just exactly how?
Suspense. Presented by Roma Wines, R-O-M-A, made in California for enjoyment throughout the world. This is Ken Niles for Roma Wines. One more day to Labor Day weekend, the traditional occasion for tasty outdoor barbecues or picnics, and your last chance to select the delicious Grand Estate wines that can add so much pleasure and good taste to your holiday dining. Yes, Grand Estate wines are becoming the choice of discriminating wine users everywhere. For in Grand Estate wines by Roma, you enjoy the brilliant clarity, full fragrance, and mellow taste that distinguish truly great wines. Your first sip of Grand Estate wine will convince you that in Grand Estate there is a difference. A difference born of choicest grapes and the patient, priceless skill of Roma, America's greatest vintner. So this weekend, enjoy the magnificent taste harmony of Grand Estate California Burgundy and juicy charcoal broiled steaks or grilled hamburgers. Or bring out the full flavor of chicken with glorious Grand Estate California Sauterne. Remember the name, Grand Estate Wines by Roma, crowning achievement of vintner skill.
Hume Cronin appeared through the courtesy of Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer, producers of the Technicolor musical Holiday in Mexico. Next Thursday, same time, Roma Wines will bring you Mr. Robert Young as star of Suspense, radio's outstanding theater of thrills.
Produced by William Spear for the Roma Wine Company of Fresno, California. This is CBS, the Columbia Broadcasting System.
Hey!
And now, Roma Wines, R-O-M-A, made in California for enjoyment throughout the world, Roma Wines present...
Suspense. Tonight, Roma Wines bring you Mr. Robert Young as star of You'll Never See Me Again, a suspense play produced, edited, and directed for Roma Wines by William Spear.
Suspense, radio's outstanding theater of thrills, is presented for your enjoyment by Roma Wines. That's R-O-M-A, Roma Wines. Those excellent California wines that can add so much pleasantness to the way you live, to your happiness in entertaining guests, to your enjoyment of everyday meals. Yes, right now, a glassful would be very pleasant as Roma Wines bring you Robert Young in a remarkable tale of...
Suspense.
Oh, you're walking out on me.
What does it look like to you?
Like you're walking out on me? Got everything you need?
Well, at least I'm glad you're showing your true colors. I'd rather have found it out now than later.
Didn't take you long, did it, baby? If you're looking for your coat, it's in here.
Thanks.
Need any money?
I don't need anything from you, including your wedding ring. Here.
Hmm.
You know what you can do with it.
Sure, hock it. Well, pick a nice, quiet hotel.
I don't have to pick a hotel. I'm no orphan.
When you get good and sick of it, come on back and... maybe I'll still be here.
You'll still be here. You'll never see me again as long as you live.
You'll never see me again as long as you live. You'll never see me again as long as you live, she said. If I'd known then what I know now, I guess that wouldn't have sounded so funny. All right, maybe I'm not the easiest guy in the world to get along with. But it's perfectly natural for a couple to have at least one good fight after they've been married nearly 3 months. And I just wasn't going to be the first one to say uncle, that's all. Still, you don't wait around forever when your wife walks out on you, even if you are playing hard to get. So, the third evening, I put in a call. I knew all along she'd head for her mother's place. Anyway, she'd practically told me where she was going when she left.
Hello?
Oh, hello. Is this Mrs. Alden?
Yes.
This is Ed, Janet's husband.
Oh, yes. How is Janet?
Well... isn't she there with you?
With me? Why, no, isn't she with you?
No. That was all I needed to hear. I grabbed my hat and headed for the bus station. That was the only way she could have possibly gone to her mother's place at that time of night, by bus. First, I wanted to find out if there was anybody who could positively identify her as having left. The guy at the ticket office wasn't very bright.
To West Hampton?
Yeah.
Well, it seems like I remember somebody like that, but...
well, it would have been Monday night, just about this time.
West Hampton, Monday night, eh? Well, maybe. I couldn't be sure, though.
Never mind. Give me a ticket.
Where to?
Where do you think? West Hampton. She was blonde, blue eyes, good looking.
Why, sure, sure. I remember her.
Where'd she get off?
I think it was West Hampton.
Oh.
Close for night, mister. Pumps are all locked.
Oh, I just wanted some information. Can you tell me where the Aldens live?
Alden? Oh, yeah. They're those new people.
Yeah.
Well, you go up to the crossroad then, and you turn to the left, and go on down the hill, and it's one, two, three, let me see, no, fourth driveway on your right.
Did anyone ask you how to get there last Monday night?
We're closed Mondays.
Oh, thanks.
Fourth driveway on your right.
Lost their
way.
Yes?
I'm Ed Bliss, Janet's husband.
Oh. Oh, yes. Come in, Ed. I've been looking forward so much to meeting you. I wish it could have been under different circumstances, though.
Yeah.
I'm so sorry.
Haven't you heard anything?
Nothing to worry about.
Can't understand it. It's not like her to do a thing like that. Oh, Ed, I want you to meet Mr. and Mrs. Farley. We were just playing a little bridge.
Hello.
How do you do?
This is my husband, Joe Alden. Well, I guess that makes him your stepfather-in-law, doesn't it? Joe, this is Ed Bliss.
Pleased to meet you, Ed.
Well, I guess we'd better be going.
Yeah, I guess we have.
I do hope that your wife...
I wouldn't worry about it.
You heard about it, did you?
Well, Ed, you see, they dropped in a little while after you phoned, and we thought...
That's all right.
Well, thanks for asking us over.
We'll come again real soon.
We'll do that.
All right. Good night.
Good night.
Oh, Ed, I hope you didn't mind about them.
Well, I didn't think it was necessary to... Oh, it's all right. It's okay.
Well, come on into the living room then and tell us about it.
And there's nothing much to tell that you don't know, is there?
No. No, I suppose not.
Sit down.
Thanks.
Can't I get you something to eat?
No, thanks.
Or some coffee or something?
I think I'll pass up the refreshments this time.
Well, I know how you must feel.
Yeah, I guess you do.
But I still can't... You've painted this room lately, haven't you?
Yeah. Well, what about it?
Nothing. It just looks a little funny, that's all.
You think so?
And that brick wall in front of the house is kind of new, too, isn't it?
You know I'm a bricklayer by trade, don't you?
Well, now that you mention it...
Oh, Joe, how can you talk about... Well...
You better go on upstairs, Laura. Ah, she's taking it pretty hard.
Yeah.
You seem to be bearing up all right, though.
You haven't lost any sleep over it yet yourself, have you?
I'm not her husband.
This isn't getting us anywhere. What was that?
Laura, I guess she's going to bed.
Oh. Well, I guess I better be going down to get that last bus.
How about staying overnight?
No, thanks.
Suit yourself. Oh, wait a minute. I'll put the port light on.
I can see.
That's better. Hey, by the way, what happened?
What do you mean, what happened?
I suppose you and Janet had a row.
What's that got to do with anything?
I hear you got kind of a temper. Were you a little too quick with the flat of your hand?
What's all this for? The benefit of the neighbors?
It might be. Have you notified the police yet?
No. I don't like the way you ask questions.
Okay, okay. Want me to walk down to the bus with you? It's pretty dark.
Maybe that's why I'd rather walk down alone.
Oh, now wait a minute, Ed. I think maybe you got me wrong.
All right, maybe I have. Say goodnight to Mrs. Alden for me.
Yeah. Let's hear from you.
Don't worry. You'll hear from me, all right. It was still plenty dark when I got back to town, but I took the shortcut at the corner just the same, a path across a vacant lot. Between the lot and my house, there's a hedge. I was just going through it when I stopped cold. There was a light on in my house, only it wasn't a regular light. It was the beam of a flashlight moving past the living room window. That could only mean one thing. Cops. Of course, it was Joe Alden that tipped them off. I just waited, and then... I heard the front door open and close, and I saw two men standing outside. And then one of them went up the street. Pretty soon, I heard a car drive off. The other man was just a shadow now, standing by a tree in front of the house. You could see he was expecting me to come from the other direction. I stepped through the hedge and went over to him. Would you be looking for anybody in particular?
I might be. Who are you?
Ed Bliss. Who are you?
Detective Stillman, Bureau of Missing Persons. How'd you know anyone was looking for you?
Oh, I'm just bright that way.
Oh, yeah? Well, they like bright boys down at headquarters. Come on, let's go.
For Suspense, Roma Wines are bringing you Robert Young in You'll Never See Me Again by Cornell Woolrich. Roma Wines' presentation tonight in radio's outstanding theater of thrills, Suspense.
Between the acts of Suspense, this is Ken Niles reminding you that it's really simple to please the palates of fastidious guests if you'll just be sure to serve Grand Estate Wines. For Grand Estate Wines, presented by Roma, afford you the ultimate in wine excellence. Discriminating wine users know this and regard your offering of Grand Estate Wines as a flattering gesture to their good taste. For in grand estate wines, particular guests find the brilliant clarity, full fragrance, and mellow taste that distinguish truly outstanding wines. You see, Roma created this limited bottling of magnificent grand estate wines especially to please those who know fine wines. With choicest grapes, infinite patience, necessary time, and age-old skill, Roma master vintners endowed each grand estate wine with fine qualities of wine greatness. So the host, who possesses all five grand estate California wines, is sure of pleasing all tastes at all times. For smart entertaining, delight your guests with grand estate medium sherry, ruby port, or golden muscatel. For gracious dining, serve grand estate burgundy or sauterne. Remember the name. Grand Estate Wines by Roma, the crowning achievement of vintner skill.
And now, Roma Wines bring back to our Hollywood soundstage Robert Young, who, as Ed Bliss in You'll Never See Me Again, continues a narrative well calculated to keep you in suspense.
Stood there in the shadows watching my face, Detective Stillman of the Bureau of Missing Persons. I'd been expecting this to happen sooner or later, but now that it had, I was stunned for a moment. He said it again.
Well, come on, bright boy. They're expecting us at headquarters.
Wait a minute. I want to talk to you. I'm in a jam.
Oh, you're telling me.
Well, not the way you think. Will you come inside with me?
I've been inside. Say, what kind of a furnace do you have in your cellar, Bliss?
An oil burner.
The kind that turns on automatic with an electric cut-in?
That's right. Why, is there a fuse blown?
How'd you know there was a fuse blown?
Was that why you were searching my house with a flashlight? Or was it because you didn't have a warrant?
You really are a bright boy, aren't you? Well, come on, we're going down.
Listen, I don't want to have any arguments. I want help, and I want it bad. Will you give me a break?
What kind of a break?
Oh, this is no place to talk. Will you come inside?
All right, okay, but you better talk fast and talk good.
Don't worry. The fuse box is right here. Flash your light, please.
Mm-hmm.
I always keep a couple of fuses on top of it. Oh, there we are. Let's go in the front room.
After you.
Okay.
Now, what do you want to talk about?
Don't you understand? She's my wife. I'm scared.
Then why did you run out? Why didn't you telephone the police?
Because at first I thought it was just, one of those things. And anyway, I knew where she'd gone, back to her mother's.
Mm-hmm. How'd you know that?
Because I went down after her. Because all kinds of people saw her. Bus drivers, ticket sellers. Only when I got there, she wasn't there.
How much life insurance do you carry on her, Bliss?
$25,000.
Well, that's quite a lot for a $75 a week architect, isn't it?
No, her mother paid for it, a wedding present. For heaven's sake, what do you think I did? Buried her in the cellar or something?
No, we know you didn't do that. We looked.
Oh, cut it out, will you? I love her. We've only been married 3 months.
Well, what do you want me to do?
Oh, give me a break. Listen, if you take me down to headquarters now, it may be hours.
It'll be hours, all right.
And in the meantime, if there's still a chance... But there's got to be. She's somewhere, and she's in danger. I know it.
Yeah, how?
I tell you, I followed her down to her mother's place in West Hampton. There's a guy at the station who remembers selling her a ticket. The bus driver remembers her getting off there. And then she just... disappeared.
Then what?
I went down to her mother's house. They hadn't seen her, but there's something funny about it. There's something funny about her mother and that stepfather. There's something funny about the house. About that room.
What room?
That living room of theirs. Listen, you've got to let me help you find her. You've got to go down there to West Hampton with me. Because I've got a hunch somehow that I'm the only one who can find her.
All right, Bliss. All right. I don't know why, but I'd believe you.
You do? Then you'll go?
Yes, and I shouldn't believe you either because...
Because what?
What was your wife wearing when she ran out on you on Monday night?
What was she wearing?
Yeah, sure. You must remember what she was wearing.
Well, she was wearing a gray flannel suit, skirt and jacket, you know, pink silk shirtwaist, patent leather high-heeled shoes, one of those crazy little hats.
Any baggage?
Yeah, a little tan suitcase.
You sure of that?
Sure.
Well, that's why I shouldn't believe it.
Why not?
Because when you find somebody's clothes around, you usually start looking for the body right nearby.
Well, what do you mean?
Well, they weren't burned up because that fuse had blown. But we found every one of those things in the furnace down in your cellar
About 20 minutes ago.
When he said that, I knew there wasn't much time. But he was going up to West Hampton with me anyway, and that was the main thing. Of course, first he had to rout out the bus driver and the ticket seller and check my story with them just to be sure I wasn't trying to pull a fast one. But that was all right. I expected that. Then we climbed into the police car and headed out to West Hampton. He believed me now, all right. And that car couldn't have been pushed any harder if I'd been driving it myself. Still, it was broad daylight when we got there. We parked the car a little ways down the road and walked towards the house. See what I mean, Bert? Take that brick wall, for instance.
Well, what about it?
It's new. What did he build that for? It's not tall enough to hide the road. It's not even tall enough to keep a dog out.
What did he build it for?
Well, maybe he built it to keep in practice. Come on. Come on, let's go in.
It's awful quiet.
Yeah. Well, why not? They're probably in bed, and that's where I would be if I hadn't let you talk me into this.
Listen, Bert, you don't think I...
I'm here, ain't I? Go on, ring the bell.
No answer.
Well, keep trying.
The shades are all down. I don't think...
Well,
they're...
come on, let's try the back door.
Shades are down on this side of the house, too.
Huh?
Look. The garage is empty.
Yeah. Well, I guess our birds have flew to coop, all right.
Bert, I don't like
come
this.
Come on, come on. We'll try this back door anyway. Oh, it's locked.
Here. Here's an axe.
Yeah, wait a minute. Let me try my keys. Oh, nuts. Ah, there. That got it. This is the way to the front of the house?
I guess so. I've never been back here.
Yeah, this is it. Here's the front hall.
There. There it is.
What?
The room. The living room I was telling you about.
Oh, what about it?
Snap on the lights.
All right, I still say, what about it?
I don't know, but don't you get something funny about it?
No, what?
The lights, or something about the fresh paint, the rug. There's something, though. I know there is.
Oh, come on, come on. We're wasting time. There's something screwy about the whole joint.
We went over the place from top to bottom. I wanted to get back to that room, and time was awful important. But Bert Stillman wanted to look into everything, which was only right and natural. Then we ran into something that was just about the last thing I expected.
Say, what's the store here?
I don't know. I thought we'd covered everything on the ground floor before.
Locked.
That must be some sort of back bedroom.
Well, the keys won't fit this one.
Funny, the only room in the house that was locked.
Well, maybe we've got what we're looking for. Give me that axe.
But, Bert, don't you see? If she was here and it's gone, they must have taken her. She's probably...
Oh. Well, who's she?
Mrs. Alden.
Your wife's mother?
Yeah.
Say, where's your daughter?
Oh, please.
Come on, come on. Where is she?
I don't know.
Was she here?
Yes.
Where's she now?
I don't know.
Did she leave with your husband?
I don't know.
Why didn't you tell me she was here the other night?
Joe told me not to. She was here. And the next morning, Joe told me she'd left. And this morning, he left it.
What did you lock yourself up in here for?
I knew when Joe left this morning that something terrible. And when you came, I was frightened.
Come on, come on. Where? Why don't you get it? For some reason, the stepfather's put the snatch on her. We've got to put a call through to headquarters and get the highway patrols on the watch for him.
Well, what about her?
Oh, she comes along.
No, please.
Come on, come on. Bert. Yes?
There's something wrong about this.
You bet your life there is.
No, I mean, why would he do it? What motive would he
Let
have?
Let me worry about the motive. You worry about your wife.
And it's got some connection with what's wrong about that room, whatever it
Will
is.
Will you forget about the room? We've got to get
I want to look at it just once more.
Listen, you, listen. Do you want your wife back or don't you? There's no time to stand...
Bert! I've got it.
Got what?
It's lopsided. Don't you see? It's not on a square.
How do you know?
I'm an architect. Look, the lights aren't in the middle of the ceiling. The windows aren't in the middle of the wall.
Well, so what?
The design of the rug is wrong. It's cut off too close to that wall. It's... Bert.
What?
That wall. That's why the room has just been repainted. That's why I built the brick wall in front of the house.
I don't get it.
One wall of this room is a dummy. Built out in front of the real one. That's why the room looks lopsided. That's why I built the brick fence to get bricks without arousing suspicion.
Which wall?
That one. And Bert, it must be hollow.
Give me that axe.
You don't think that the janitor...
Bert, give it to me.
Get back. Get back. You hurt me. Get back.
Mrs. Holden. Did you... Is Janet...
Answer me.
He couldn't have done a thing like that.
Hey. Ed.
Yes?
Didn't you say your wife was young?
23.
Well, then you can look. This is an older woman. Do you...
Oh.
You know her?
No.
Well, there's your motive.
Yeah.
But who could it be?
I don't know.
Well, she must know, the mother.
She can't even talk.
Say, Ed... Ed, you would know if she was the mother, wouldn't you?
Of course I... What? No, I wouldn't. I never saw Janet's mother until I came here to the house Monday night.
Oh. Mrs. Alden. Mrs. Alden, answer me.
I'm not Mrs. Alden. That's Mrs. Alden.
Just a question of time now, whether we get back there in time to stop it. It all fit together now, and what Bert didn't know, he got out of the woman on the way back.
Did you know Joe Alden before?
No, not before I came to their house in Eastport to take care of her. I was her nurse, and Joe and I, well...
Who got the idea to kill her, you or Joe?
He did. When he saw me giving her a sedative one, she was pretty sick.
Premeditated, eh? Why did you do it?
Money, of course.
She kept a lot of bonds around the house. That's what Joe wanted.
Is that why you moved from Eastport to West Hampton?
Yes. Nobody knew us in West Hampton. We moved in at night. They thought there was only the two of us. They thought I was the real Mrs. Alden.
When did he do it?
About a week after we got there. One night. By morning, she was where you found her.
We were doing better than 80 most of the way, but I still didn't think we'd make it. And naturally, Bert was afraid to put the local cops around the house for fear Alden would spot them first and take Janet away. And do it somewhere else. If he hadn't done it already. Because Bert had the picture cold now. Janet had come to the West Hampton house and found her mother was missing before Alden had been able to make his getaway. So Alden had to kill Janet, too. He knew where he was taking her because of the clothes in the furnace of my house. That was the tip-off that Joe was going to try to plant it on me. The only break I had. At least I knew where to look if I could get there in time. At the outskirts of town, we picked up a police escort. Bert made them lay off when we got near the house. We drove up the side street and parked a little ways off. We walked up to the house. There was a car in front of it.
Is that Alden's car?
Yes.
All right. Now, you're coming in with us, lady, but the first sound out of you and I'll shoot, and I mean that.
I know.
Got your keys, Ed?
Yeah.
Yeah, quiet. Look. Look, there's a light.
That's the door to the cellar.
Come on.
Listen. Huh? He's digging.
The lights have gone out. He must have heard us.
Put on your flashlight.
Come on, let's go.
There he is.
Ed, why are you... Hey! Hey. Ed, you shouldn't have done that.
He killed my wife, didn't he?
Switch on the light. Where is she? Maybe it isn't too late.
There she is. She's dead.
Yeah. Yeah, chloroform. You smell it? Come on, get that cloth off her face.
It's too late. Can't you see?
Yeah, yeah, I'm afraid, Ed. Right. Say, wait a minute. What are you doing carrying a gun, Ed?
Well, I got a permit. Mm. Anyway, what's the use of asking questions like that now?
But she's moving.
What?
She's alive. Here. Come on, Ed. Give me a hand, quick.
Ed.
Here, Ed. Come on, help me. Hey. Hey, Ed, where are you going? Ah! Put up your hands, Ed. Okay.
They're up.
Ed, you could at least have done it yourself instead of hiring a murderer.
What did you do it for, Ed? The money?
What do you think? For fun?
Go ahead. Talk.
Anything to make you happy.
Would have been perfect if Alden had killed her when he first got her in the cellar like I told him to. Maybe he had a sneaking idea I was going to double-cross him. He was stalling until the last minute. I don't know. Anyway, it won't do him much good where he is.
Mm. What'd you have on him, Ed?
The mother, his wife. I'd been up there before, alone. I knew he'd killed his wife because I'd seen a picture that Janet had of the real wife. I spotted the room right away. Told Alden I'd split the money with him if he took care of Janet. And if he didn't...
Go on.
I knew I could pick a fight with Janet, and I knew she'd run up to her mother's. And I went up there to make it look good. After I left, Alden was to call the cops like he did. You'd take me down here to headquarters, and while you were giving me the old third degree, Alden was supposed to plant the body in the cellar. That way, I was in the clear, because you know I couldn't have done it while I was down here talking to you. You know she hadn't been there before because you'd look. That's why I planted the clothes in the furnace, remember? So you would look.
Mm.
I had an alibi. Nobody had a thing on Alden, unless I squawked. And he had to take that chance. Yeah, looked pretty good there for a while, didn't it?
Yeah. Your wife's outside. Want to say anything to her?
Huh? Oh, just tell her I said, you'll never see me again.
Suspense.
Presented by Roma Wines, R-O-M-A, made in California for enjoyment throughout the world. And now, here is our producer-director, William Spear, with a basket of Grand Estate wines, a gift for the distinguished star of tonight's suspense play, Robert Young.
Bob, these Grand Estate wines are our way of thanking you for a really wonderful performance.
Well, thank you, Bill, for this wonderful basket.
You know, Mr. Young, each Grand Estate wine is a limited bottling of outstanding excellence. Presented by Roma, the greatest name in wine. Each precious bottle is distinguished by brilliant clarity, full fragrance, and mellow taste. Yes, the name Grand Estate Wine stands for the ultimate in wine goodness.
I'm impressed, and I've learned something.
Well, discriminating wine users everywhere are learning, Mr. Young. They're finding out that Grand Estate Wines offer a rich new experience in wine enjoyment. Choicest grapes and the patient perfection of winemaking serve to establish Grand Estate Wines by Roma as the crowning achievement of vintner skill.
Very convincingly spoken, Ken. And Mr. Young's gift basket of Grand Estate Wines will convince him still more. Bob, it's always great to have you on Suspense. I'm sorry we had to make such a heel out of you at the end, but that's what you get for being such a two-way stretch of an actor.
Well, I'll get a two-way verdict on the show when I get home tonight. Kids will be furious because they know I'm such a nice guy. But my wife will say that Suspense is the only show that ever lets me play my true villainous self.
How is Betty?
Fine.
Well, congratulations again, Bob. I hear that Lady Luck, the picture you've just finished at RKO, is swell. Well, I'll be looking forward to seeing it.
Well, you're very kind, Bill. Who's on Suspense next Thursday?
It's a double threat. Lloyd Nolan and Vincent Price. In a play about two lifelong enemies who go away on a hunting trip together, both knowing that only one of them is ever coming back alive.
Well, it sounds terrific, Bill. I won't miss it.
Swell. And now, Bob, with my compliments and Roma's, here's that gift basket of Grand Estate wines.
Thank you again. And good night.
Next Thursday, same time, listen to Vincent Price and Lloyd Nolan on Suspense.
Presented by the Roma Wine Company, Fresno, California. This is CBS, the Columbia Broadcasting System.
And now, Roma Wines, R-O-M-A, made in California for enjoyment throughout the world, Roma Wines present Suspense.
Tonight, Roma Wines bring you Mr. Vincent Price and Mr. Lloyd Nolan as stars of Hunting Trip, a suspense play produced, edited, and directed for Roma Wines by William Spear.
Suspense, radio's outstanding theater of thrills, is presented for your enjoyment by Roma Wines. That's R-O-M-A, Roma Wines. Those excellent California wines that can add so much pleasantness to the way you live, to your happiness in entertaining guests, to your enjoyment of everyday meals. Yes, right now, a glassful would be very pleasant, as Roma Wines bring you Lloyd Nolan and Vincent Price in a remarkable tale of
suspense.
It began with just a little hunting trip for the two of us, Eric and me. I hadn't seen Eric for several months, since before Karen died, in fact. When I bumped into him at the club, he suggested that we run up to his cabin in the mountains for a few days, grab a bit of fresh air and relaxation, see if we couldn't bag ourselves a moose or a deer. And yet, almost at the outset, I had an uncanny feeling about that trip. I suppose, actually, it was the night and the setting. It was the blackest night I'd ever seen. We'd left all humankind behind us. There was no moon. There was only blackness, the kind that seemed to be all-enveloping, as though there was nothing outside our car but blackness. No road, no forest, no mountains. Well, I'd admit I was nervous. I was boring my feet into the floorboard of the car, as though somehow that would help. What are you laughing at?
You, Stan. You don't look as though you're having a very good time.
Well, I'm not. I, frankly, shouldn't you be driving a little bit slower?
Why?
Why, good heavens, Eric, if you make just one little slip at the wheel, we're done for, that's all. I doubt if they'd ever even find us down in those canyons.
Nonsense. I know every crook and turn in this road.
Oh, yeah?
I don't think you're much of an outdoors man,
Stan. Well, maybe not. I love this kind of country in the daytime, but I'll confess I'm not so keen on it at night. I don't like what I can't see.
Funny, I'm just the opposite. There's a challenge in the darkness that stimulates my senses. Hmm. It's exhilarating. It stirs my imagination.
Well, sure, I suppose it would. But I'm not equipped to grapple with the mysteries of the universe.
Stan, you're much too modest. You always were. You've gotten out of life pretty much what you wanted, haven't you?
Well, yes, I suppose so.
And then don't always be belittling yourself. It's an effective technique, Stan, but I'm on to you. You're as clever as the next fellow, in your own way.
I sat back and tried to relax. Things weren't quite as Eric had pictured them. I was born with a silver spoon in my mouth, as they say. Eric had come up the hard way. I was average and soft. He was brilliant and hard. We'd known each other a long time, going to school together, being in love with the same girl, Karen. When I married her, he was my best man, and yet I didn't pretend to understand him. He was still pretty much of a stranger to me. I glanced over his way. He actually seemed to be enjoying himself. It crossed my mind that he was rather enjoying seeing me in a bit of a lather, too.
Well, it's not far now, just around the next bend.
Well, thank the Lord. Well, am I amusing you again?
No. I was just thinking what a perfect spot this would be for a murder.
A murder? Honestly, Eric, I believe that's all you think about.
It is, almost. When I buy a newspaper, I read about murder the way you study the stock quotations. Murder is fascinating to me. I spend most of my time figuring out ways and means to commit murder.
Now you're trying to sound like a mental case.
Who knows? Perhaps I am. I have a mind. Well, here we are, old man. You see, I've delivered you safe and sound, all in one piece.
Eric's cabin was perched high on a rocky crag jutting out from the side of a mountain, with one wall flush against a sheer drop. In front, there was a steep path leading down to a lake. I could hear the lapping of the waves. Eric fixed us something to eat, then went outside. And pretty soon, he came back in, an armful of logs. His face was red and healthy.
I don't think you like my place, Stan.
Huh? Oh, yes, I do. Honestly, I'm just tired, I guess.
Well, we'll turn in directly.
Oh, thanks.
Cigarette?
Yes, thanks. I believe I will.
I like it here. All the privacy in the world.
Mm-hmm. Say, Eric.
Yes?
Why do you read about murder?
Why do you read about stocks and bonds?
Well, because they interest me. It's my business.
My business doesn't interest me. I read about murder because I'm interested in people. Murder is emotional. And when people are being emotional, you get to see more of them.
Why are you so interested in people?
Oh, I think I'm more curious than interested.
Well, all right. Why so curious?
Well, it amuses me. I find out about people. I write down what I find out, and I write my impressions of how those people will react to a series of circumstances. It's a good way to get rid of one's inhibitions.
Sort of a frightening hobby.
I think stamp collecting is frightening.
You're too darn clever, Eric.
Why too clever?
Well, I mean you see through people.
Well, what's wrong with that? Unless, of course, they have something they want to hide.
Oh, I suppose it's all right, if your friends don't mind.
Do you?
Mine? No, heavens no. Why should I?
That's right. Why should you? Well, how about hitting the hay? We have to be up early. We'll only get a few hours sleep as it is.
That suits me.
You sleep in my study, Stan. The bed's in there is a bit more comfortable. I'll bunk out here on the couch.
I had undressed and gotten into bed and was reaching over to put out the light on Eric's desk when my eyes fell on a stack of typewritten sheets. I wondered if they were the notes Eric had been speaking about. The strange mumbo-jumbo he'd written there, phrases he liked, single sentences describing people he'd met. There were a few clippings pasted on sheets of white paper, clippings describing murders by strangulation, by pistol, by drowning, by poison. The full sheet was devoted to Karen. I hadn't realized how much he'd cared for her. His analysis was very kind, almost maudlin. He spoke of his shock at hearing of her suicide. He tried to reason it, to find causes. A small memo pad caught my eye, however. And on the last page, I saw my name carefully printed. I read it eagerly. I read Eric's arguments for not hating me because I had married Karen. I read Eric's cold analysis of my character. Not exactly flattering, but it was pretty accurate. And at the bottom of the page, newly written by the looks of it, and in Eric's own careful hand, I read, "Four ways to commit murder. By strangulation, by pistol bullet, by drowning, by poison."
For Suspense, Roma Wines are bringing you Vincent Price and Lloyd Nolan in Hunting Trip by Paul Bernard and Lee Horton. Roma Wines' presentation tonight in radio's outstanding theater of thrills, Suspense.
Between the acts of Suspense, this is Ken Niles for Grand Estate Wines. Last night, a friend who entertains frequently told me how much he likes Grand Estate wines, those wines of outstanding excellence presented by Roma, America's greatest vintner. Here's what he said. "Recently, Ken, I served Grand Estate wine to some very particular guests, people who really know wine. Their sincere praise for that wonderful fragrance and taste was certainly flattering to me as a host. Grand Estate wines are outstanding." Yes, to bring you this limited bottling of Grand Estate wines, Roma selected only the choicest juice-laden grapes from California's finest vineyards. Then at Roma's famed wineries, unmatched in winemaking resources, Grand Estate wines are patiently, skillfully guided to perfection. Necessary time and the age-old skill of Roma master vintners endow each Grand Estate wine with brilliant clarity, full fragrance, and mellow taste. So, whatever the occasion, you're sure to please all tastes with Grand Estate California wines. Medium sherry, ruby port, and golden muscatel for delightful entertaining. Grand Estate Burgundy and Sauterne for gracious dining. Remember the name, Grand Estate Wines by Roma, the crowning achievement of vintner skill.
And now, Roma Wines bring back to our Hollywood soundstage Lloyd Nolan as Stan and Vincent Price as Eric in Hunting Trip, a tale well calculated to keep you in suspense.
I suppose I slept that night, but it seemed as though I had only just dozed off when I heard the door open quietly. I opened one eye cautiously. It was still gray in the room, so I know I hadn't slept long. I was about to open both eyes to save Eric the trouble of waking me when I thought, he hasn't come to wake me. My mind threw two words at me. By strangulation. Before I had the chance to move, I felt his hands carefully on my throat.
Don't! Why, Stan, what's the matter?
I thought for a minute that...
Yes?
I guess I must have been dreaming. Nightmare.
You grabbed hold of my hands like you thought I was going to strangle you.
Oh, did I?
What's the matter? Have you got a guilty conscience?
Yeah. Yeah, I guess I have. What did you want, Eric?
Time to get up.
Oh, already?
Yeah, that's right. I've got good news, too. I just spotted a likely-looking buck right across the lake when I went down for water.
Oh, good, good.
Well, I'll get breakfast going. As soon as you're ready.
Yeah, be right with you.
Now, there's no rush. Take your time. Nice to have you here, old
son. Well, maybe it was the way that he'd said that, as though he'd really meant it. For a minute, I was convinced that I'd let my imagination run away with me. And as for putting his hand on my throat, that was an accident. He'd been groping for my shoulder. And then the next minute, I was asking myself, was it an accident, though? Suppose I'd really been asleep. Suppose I hadn't grabbed his hands. I still didn't know what to think. Well, I dressed, and we sat down to breakfast.
Oh, pass me your cup, will you, Stan? I'll give you some coffee. There you are.
Thanks.
Sugar coming up.
No sugar for me, thanks.
Well, Stan, when are you going to confess?
What do you mean, confess?
Or shall I drag it out of you?
What are you driving at?
Oh, come now. You're not going to play the adolescent schoolboy with me.
I swear, I don't...
I'm referring to the lovely young woman you've been seen dining with and taking to the theater.
Oh, you mean Marcia.
Is that her name?
Yes.
Well, go on. Where did you meet her? How? When? Is she wealthy? Is she as beautiful as they say she is? Come on. Let's have the sordid details.
No, Eric, you're barking up the wrong tree.
Am I?
Oh, I'll admit I've taken her out occasionally, but nothing like that.
Marcia. Do I know her?
No, I don't believe you do.
Isn't her last name Jenkins?
Yes.
Oh, of course I know her. That is, I met her. Well, don't you remember? You introduced me to her yourself.
Oh, did I?
Yes, don't you remember? I ran into you at Silver's. You were buying perfume, and she was helping you select it for Karen. Remember?
Oh, yes. Now that you recall it...
More coffee?
Yeah, no sugar. Well, when we got to the lake, we bailed out the boat, loaded it, and pushed it out into the fog. It was still half light when we reached the other side, so we sat in the boat and lighted cigarettes, waited for the sun to come up. We'd been sitting there, just smoking, not saying anything, when he suddenly turned to me and said...
You say that she'd been ill.
Karen. Yes. Yes, she'd been ill for some time, Eric.
So she killed herself.
Yeah.
There was an inquest, of course.
Well, yes, of course. Why do you ask?
Look at that sun. Did you ever see such color?
Four ways to commit murder. I'd almost forgotten about Eric's hands on my throat. Now the incident jumped vividly back to my mind because now I knew that Eric had a reason. He looked away after he asked me about the inquest. He didn't answer me when I asked him why he wanted to know. Somewhere in that strange, dark corner of his mind, he was still obsessed by love for Karen, even though she was dead and gone. He thought that she'd still be alive and happy if she hadn't married me. Legs were weak when he motioned me out of the boat. A deer blew somewhere near us. We stopped.
Hey, did you hear that?
Yeah.
Listen, it's moving west.
Yeah.
Stan, you work west. Just about half a mile or so ahead of us, you'll come to a clearing.
Mm-hmm.
Take your stand there.
Right.
I'll strike north and west and then work toward the clearing. Good hunting.
This is it, then, I thought. He'll hide somewhere along the way to the clearing and shoot me in the back. Now that I knew what to expect, I felt somewhat relieved. At least I'd be ready for him. Nothing happened until I'd nearly reached the clearing. And then I got the feeling that someone was walking with me, timing his steps with mine. I stopped and listened. I don't know how long I stood there, my rifle gripped in my hands. But suddenly, instinctively, I wheeled around. A shot whistled over my head. Then I saw a buck running across the clearing. He'd shot at me and missed. Well, two can play at that game, I thought. The next shot would be mine. I wouldn't miss. I dropped to my knees watching the brush for him. Then all of a sudden, I saw him running toward me, right out in the open. I started to raise my rifle, but I couldn't. I couldn't kill a man that way in cold blood.
Stan. Did I hit you?
No, confound you.
Now, hold on a minute, old son. Let's not lose our heads. I'm terribly sorry, of course, but I had no idea you were to take Stan in the clearing, so I naturally assumed you were there. I don't know what I can say.
Well, maybe it was my fault. I don't know. Anyway, let's forget it.
But
I said let's skip it. I stuck close to Eric after that. I gave no more opportunity for a shooting accident. It was dusk when we headed back toward the cabin. We didn't get our buck, not that I cared, and I'm sure Eric didn't. He was after a different game. Then I saw a boat on the beach. By drowning. Here we were alone. I couldn't refuse to get in the boat with him. There was no other way of getting back to the cabin. I could feel the perspiration trickling down my ribs. I stumbled in the underbrush.
Easy, easy now. Hey, it's too bad we didn't bag that fella.
What?
That buck. Better luck tomorrow, maybe.
Yeah, better luck tomorrow.
You seem preoccupied, Stan.
Do I?
Yes, I have the ghastly feeling that I'm failing you as a host. I don't think you're having a very good time.
I think this is a marvelous country, Eric.
You've exercised phenomenal restraint, old son.
What do you mean?
About expressing your admiration for it. I'd never have suspected that you liked it so much.
That remark called for some sort of an answer, but I wasn't equal to it. Fortunately, I was spared the necessity. We reached the lake and the boat. Then we tossed our guns into it. Eric started to push out to the shore.
Hop in, Stan. Easy does it now. Hang on to the oars, will you, while I climb in? All set?
All set.
Splendid. Here, now, you better let me row. I know this lake. There's some treacherous spots in it.
What do you mean?
Oh, some nasty boulders sticking up. Some of them that aren't easy to spot. Come too close to the surface for comfort.
I see.
If we were to hit one of them, we'd turn over in a hurry. You don't swim, do you, Stan?
You know darn well I don't.
Oh, that's a shame. It's a mistake not to learn to swim, don't you think?
What happened after that was a nightmare. He rowed. I sat there, paralyzed. I couldn't move. I couldn't think. I knew I should do something, but what? I stared at the water till I was blind, looking for rocks. Eric's face was a blur. He just smiled, rowed and talked. His voice sounded hollow and unreal.
You're shaking, Stan. Is something wrong? This lake's plenty deep. Lots of fish in it, too. Maybe we can do a little fishing.
He stopped suddenly. He'd seen something in the water. He turned around, pulled hard on the oars. We'd reached the spot, he knew it. And then...
No! No, Eric, you killed! Eric, with the love of God! Eric, you killed!
came up. Eric was there in the water near me. He didn't speak. He just grinned. And then I saw his face above mine, grinning. I saw him raise his face, strike me, and that's the last I remember.
When I came to, I was lying on the beach, and Eric was standing over me, smiling.
Well, hello. How are you feeling?
Okay, I guess.
Say, you're a tough customer to rescue, old son. You put up quite a fight.
I'm sorry. I thought
now,
that maybe...
No, don't try to talk now. You've had a pretty bad time. Take it easy.
Well, it was all clear to me then. Eric had saved my life. It'd have been accidental. The shot, the boat turning over. He didn't want to kill me. A man doesn't save you from drowning when he wants you dead. But it all been my imagination, a nightmare. Oh, the relief that flowed through my body was almost too much for me. It would... Well, there aren't words to express how I felt. A little later, Eric helped me up to my cabin, and I stretched out on the couch. Eric went to the kitchen to fix hot coffee and soup. He brought the coffee in first, pulled up a coffee table close to me, and poured us each out a cupful.
There you are. Get some of that into you, and you'll feel different.
Oh, thanks.
I'll be back in a second. Soup coming right up. Hey, Stan, do you like to cook?
Huh?
I said, do you like to cook? You know, I do. I like to try different concoctions.
Oh, not me. I'd starve to death if I had to cook for myself. Oh, man. This coffee hits the spot.
Yeah. I can use a little of that, too. It sure does warm the innards, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
I got a little chilled.
Nothing like a cup of coffee, I always say.
That's what I always say, too, Stan.
Yeah. Why did I say something funny? Am I amusing you again?
Immensely. Yeah. In fact, Stan, I think that's probably the funniest thing you ever said. Mm-hmm. How did you like it, Stan? 4 ways to commit murder. You read it, of course.
Why, yes, I
couldn't tell you had, just as I intended you to. Were you frightened all day today?
I don't understand.
You didn't know, did you, that I came to your engagement party to ask Karen to be my wife. I wasn't aware that you were throwing a party or that she had accepted you.
Oh, good Lord.
Perhaps you don't remember what I told you that night. You thought I was joking, but I meant every word I said. That I'd make you pay if you failed Karen, if you made her unhappy.
But then all these years you would... Then you did bring me up here to...
Murder you? You're so right, Stan.
But you pulled me out of the lake. You saved my life.
You are a dull-witted clown, aren't you, Stan? Don't you know me better than that? Did you think I'd kill you in the manner of a homicidal moron? Oh, no, Stan.
But you did take a shot at me.
Oh, yes. That was the second way. The first way was by waking you up by the throat this morning. The boat tipping over was the third way.
And now I suppose we've reached the fourth way.
Your brilliance positively staggers me.
You can't get away with it, Eric.
Oh, yes, I can. I have. You see how intently I'm watching you? I'm waiting to see you fall. You're going to die, Stan, just as Karen died.
What do you mean?
In the coffee stand. That's right. Your coffee's poisoned, just as you poisoned her coffee. Only yours is a slow poison. Poetic justice, don't you think?
You poisoned my coffee?
Yes, I wore down your guard. I planned it so that by now you would trust me. You would have faith in me.
You poisoned my coffee?
What have you...
I didn't drink my coffee, Eric. I changed cups with you. There was sugar in my cup, Eric. I don't take sugar in my coffee, Eric. So I change cups with you. I didn't mean to do it, Eric, but... I don't like sugar in my coffee. So you see,
I didn't kill Eric Grimley. He killed himself accidentally, but I wish he had killed me. He had a good reason to, because somehow he knew about Karen, about how I killed Karen, by putting poison in her coffee that morning. And I watched her die, the same way that I watched Eric die. I'm tired now. I don't want to talk anymore. You do whatever you want with me.
Presented by Roma Wines, R-O-M-A, made in California for enjoyment throughout the world. And now, our two distinguished stars, Lloyd Nolan and Vincent Price, are returning for a curtain call with William Spear, our producer-director of Suspense. Mr. Spear is carrying two large gift baskets of Grand Estate California wines.
Lloyd and Vincent and Lloyd, just to keep the billing straight, we want you each to have a basket of these Grand Estate wines with our compliments for a thrilling performance.
Oh, okay. Thank you, Bill. Hey, this is quite a selection.
It certainly is. My thanks, too, Bill. Well, there must be a Grand Estate wine for every occasion here. Well,
I guess there is, isn't there, Ken?
Well, there is indeed, Bill. Even my favorite, Grand Estate Medium Sherry. A truly versatile wine, Grand Estate Medium Sherry is delicious as an aperitif before dinner. Delightful for afternoon or evening parties, too. And, of course, like all Grand Estate wines by Roma, Medium Sherry possesses the brilliant clarity, full fragrance, and mellow taste that distinguish truly great wines.
That sounds wonderful.
Well, yes, Mr. Nolan, and you can be sure that any Grand Estate wine you serve represents the ultimate in wine goodness, the crowning achievement of vintner skill. That's why Grand Estate wines presented by Roma, the greatest name in wine, are the choice of discriminating wine users everywhere.
Well put, Ken. Vincent, what's new and startling over on the 20th Century Fox lot?
Well, they're pretty excited about Daryl Zanuck's film version of Mom's The Razor's Edge, which has just finished up shooting.
And I guess the picture that they liked best among the current releases is Claudia and David.
You're on loan out just now, away from the home lot, aren't you, Vincent?
That's right, Bill. And Lloyd is, too.
Oh. Yes, sir. I will be in a couple of weeks. Right now, I'm just loafing, grabbed a little fishing, took a hunting trip up north.
You wouldn't want to go on a hunting trip with me, would you, Lloyd?
No, thanks. And plenty of that tonight on Suspense. Bill, who's on the show next Thursday?
It's Dane Clark in a suspense play about a gunsel, a professional murderer who doesn't know he has any emotions until he finds himself falling in love with the wife of a man he's killed.
Sounds wonderful. We'll be listening, eh, Lloyd?
Oh, yeah, sure thing.
Swell. Well, then, if you two will relieve me of these baskets of Grand Estate wines before my arms give way, there's a loud crash.
Thanks again, Bill.
Well, good night.
Good night.
Next Thursday, same time, listen to Dane Clark on Suspense.
Presented by Roma Wine Company of Fresno, California. CBS, the Columbia Broadcasting System.
Officer, you see a fellow just come out of here?
What fellow?
Gray suit, blue tie, rose in the buttonhole.
No.
He's gone. Now, what do you make of that? The guy gives me a 20 instead of a 1 and disappears. Well, I can do business like that all day long. I won't forget that, gent. No, sir.
I arrived home at 6:30. Laura wasn't there. The table wasn't set. Well, she was probably late shopping. I went upstairs and found the bottle in the medicine chest. The cyanate matched the powder in the bottle perfectly. She'd never be able to tell the difference. I poured half the bottle's contents into the sink, marked with my finger the level of the medicine, and then refilled the bottle with cyanate up to the mark and shook it so as to mix it thoroughly. I emptied the rest of the poison in the sink, and I let the water run for a minute. There. It was done. Everything accomplished. And very neatly, too. All I had to do now was wait. I glanced at the bedroom door. It was closed. All the doors on the second floor were closed. That's another thing. That's another thing I hated about Laura. So precise about her housekeeping, everything in its place. Even to closing doors when a room wasn't in use. I went back downstairs and I tried to light a cigarette. My hands were beginning to shake. Nerves again. I took a book from the table by the sofa, tried to read. Then I realized what I was reading. Funny I should have picked up that book. Memory album of Oliver and Laura Littlefield. And a dance program tied in pink ribbon. Homecoming Dance, Indiana University, 1928. First anniversary. Oliver and Laura Littlefield celebrating their first anniversary, July the 12th, 1929. They invite you to an informal tea. Suddenly, I was lonesome for Laura. I missed her. Where was she? Why was she so late? I wanted to hear her voice. Even if she nagged me, it didn't really matter. I wanted to hear her say something. I thought back over the events of that day. I thought of my married life with Laura. Hadn't been as bad as I let myself believe. Hadn't been bad at all. Laura loved me. She did. She did love me, and I loved her. I must have been crazy to even think of killing her. What would I ever do without her? I leaped to my feet, and I ran up the stairs to the medicine chest. I poured the cyanate down the drain, all of it. Washed out the sink with my hand to be sure that the last bit of the poison was gone. After that, I was calmer again. I guess I'd come to my senses. I thought of the blue tie I was wearing, the one Laura didn't like. I changed that before dinner. I opened the door of the bedroom and... Then I saw, sprawled on the bed, her face distorted in pain. I went to the bed and I shook her. Laura! Laura! She didn't move. She was cold, terribly cold. Hello? Hello, Dr. Thacker? Doctor, this is Oliver Littlefield. Can you come over right away? Something's happened to my wife. I think she's dead.
I'm afraid you were right, Mr. Littlefield.
She's...
This glass she drank from, it's poison.
But why? Why?
I'm afraid, sir, it looks like suicide.
Suicide? She wouldn't do that. She had no reason. She
had a reason, Mr. Littlefield. Your wife was dying of an incurable disease.
But that's not true. She would have told me.
She wanted to keep it from you. Those were her wishes. I'm sorry, Mr. Littlefield.
Without saying anything more, he left the room. I sat there staring at Laura. My mind was a blank. I don't know how long it was until Dr. Thacker came back.
Mr. Littlefield.
What is it?
This bottle.
Huh? Well, that's the medicine you prescribed for my wife.
I think not.
Of course it is. Why, what are you talking about?
I didn't prescribe cyanide.
Well,
It seems that I may be obliged to revise my diagnosis of your wife's death.
I don't understand.
Well, really, Mr. Littlefield, isn't it quite obvious? Your wife's death was caused by a lethal dosage of cyanate. Her medicine bottle was filled with cyanate. The odor is still there.
Yes, but I can explain that. You see, there wasn't a bit of it left. I threw it all away. She must have bought some herself.
I hardly think she'd fill her medicine bottle with poison if she intended to commit suicide.
Now, wait a minute. You've got to listen to me. I didn't do it. I didn't do it, if that's what you're thinking. Dr. Thacker, you've known me for a long time. You can take my word for
Hello,
it.
Hello, operator. Get me the police.
You see, it started with that blue tie. It made my eyes look bluer. Everybody told me I was sick. I started to feel sick.
Yes, that's right. This is an emergency.
Then the Rosebud and Mr. Bevins and the Maxidrine. I didn't know what I was doing for a while.
Hello, this is Dr. Thacker. You'd better send someone to 6931 Kilbourne right away.
You know, people can drive you out of your mind if they keep saying the same thing to you over and over again.
Beg pardon?
You've got to listen. You've got to listen. It was the blue tie. Laura started it. She said I was hollow-eyed.
No, it looks like homicide.
It all happened in 12 short hours. But since then, the hours have been long, endless eternity.
And now, Roma Wines, R-O-M-A, made in California for enjoyment throughout the world, Roma Wines present...
Suspense! Tonight, Roma Wines bring you Mr. Hume Cronin as star of Blue Eyes. A suspense play produced, edited, and directed for Roma Wines by William Spear.
Suspense, radio's outstanding theater of thrills, is presented for your enjoyment by Roma Wines. That's R-O-M-A, Roma Wines, those excellent California wines that can add so much pleasantness to the way you live, to your happiness in entertaining guests, to your enjoyment of everyday meals. Yes, right now, a glass full would be very pleasant, as Roma Wines bring you Hume Cronin in a remarkable tale of...
Suspense!
Today began just like any other day. I got to bed early last night because I had to go over the accounts with Mr. Bevins. When you go over the accounts with old Hawkshaw, you've got to be in tip-top shape. Well, I dressed myself rather carefully this morning. I put on the necktie with the little flowers on it, the blue and red one. Jane said she liked it. Told me it matched my eyes. Made them look bluer. I went down to breakfast. My wife, Laura, was having her coffee.
Good morning, Oliver.
Good morning, dear.
I'll have to warm your coffee. Here's the paper.
Thanks.
Oliver, must you wear that tie?
Hmm?
That frightful necktie. It's not at all becoming.
Well... matches my suit.
It's a perfectly dreadful shade. Makes you look like a rube.
I like it.
Well, I don't. And I wish you wouldn't wear it. Oliver, aren't you listening to me?
Oh, sure, sure. I was reading.
Oh, well, don't let my conversation disturb you.
That's all right.
Oliver!
What's wrong now?
Oliver, I don't know what's gotten into you lately. You forget things. You scarcely seem to hear a word I say. Aren't you feeling well?
I feel fine. Why shouldn't I?
Well, you look a bit drawn. I believe I'd better make an appointment for you with Dr. Thacker.
Look, Laura, there's nothing the matter with me. I better get going now. I'll be late.
But you haven't finished your breakfast.
Well, that's all I want. I'm not very hungry. Where's my briefcase?
On the hall table. Oliver, are you sure you're not ill? You look positively hollow-eyed.
I never felt better in my life.
Well...
see you tonight, dear. Goodbye.
Oliver!
Yes?
I hope you'll all... oh, nothing. Goodbye.
Laura was like that, a chronic worrier. She seemed to take delight in fretting about things that wouldn't even occur to the average person. Imagine me not feeling well. Why, I've never had a sick day in my life. There on the trellis was my prize rose bush. Climbing talisman, they call it. Suddenly, I was thinking of Jane. Perhaps if I put a rosebud in my buttonhole, Jane would notice. She'd say something about how the scent matched her perfume, and maybe we'd talk about roses. And I could impress her, because I know quite a lot about roses. I was just about to pick one of the buds.
Well. Good morning, Mr. Littlefield. Good morning. Two letters for you today.
Good morning, Mr. Crowley.
Well, I see you're doing a little gardening, huh?
Oh, no, I was just sort of looking the garden over.
Well, it's a mighty fine garden you got there, Mr. Littlefield. Worked pretty hard on it, I suppose.
Yes, I've given it my fair share of time.
Oh, yes. A little too much, maybe, hmm?
I beg your pardon?
Well, it pays to be on the safe side, Mr. Littlefield. Now, of course, it ain't none of my business, but it seems to me that you're getting to look a little peaked. You better go easy.
Yes. Well,
son, you know.
Good morning, Mr. Crowley.
Yes, sir. Good morning to you, sir. I gotta get going anyway.
It was the second time. The second time I'd heard it, and the day was hardly more than an hour old. First Laura, and now the postman. I felt all right. I felt swell. I thought of the rosebud again. I bent down, snipped off a bud from the bush. Had to take the red cross pin out of my lapel to get the rose in, but I didn't mind taking the time. After all, 1 minute more or less never harmed anyone. I didn't know then how precious a minute can be. I glanced at my watch, 8:23. I had to run part of the way to the station. I arrived out of breath, panting, perspiring a bit, but I made it. Steve and Joe helped me aboard.
Hey! Oliver, you ought to get an earlier start in the morning.
I was delayed at the house.
Boy, listen to old Ollie Wheeze. And you're the guy who used to be a track star in high school. Where's the old wind, Ollie?
Oh, I'm all right. Just a second now.
Seriously, Oliver, it's dangerous business for a man of your age to be running around that way.
Man of my age? Listen to him. You'd think I was 80.
Say, know what you need? Maxidrine. Pep you up, make you feel like a million.
I tell you, there's nothing wrong with me.
I got two or three here with me. A little box. A pocket here somewhere. Ah, here we are. Let me make a little present. Non-habit forming, you know.
Maxidrine? What do I want with Maxidrine?
You keep them in your pocket. Take a half of one with some water when you get that sagged out feeling, you know? Pep you up like a million. Make a new man out of you.
It's getting to be just like a club. All you had to do to get a membership was to smile at me and say, Mr. Littlefield, you look a little sick. Mr. Littlefield, you look a little peaked. Mr. Littlefield, why don't you just find some nice quiet corner and go and curl up and die, Mr. Littlefield? It was 9 o'clock when I got to the office. I noticed a lumpy feeling in my solar plexus. Right here, a little on the left by my heart. It was just indigestion, of course. I got my accounts together and I went into Mr. Bevan's outer office. There was Jane at her desk. She looked lovely this morning. Sunlight coming through the Venetian blinds seemed to blend with her blonde hair. All at once, I wondered why I'd ever married Laura. Sunlight never did anything to hurt me. How long will I have to wait? How long until they file out of that room and tell me what I already know? The coroner's jury find that Laura Littlefield met her death by poisoning. It's recommended that her husband, Oliver Littlefield, be held to answer. I can hear it now. There's no other verdict. The testimony of the librarian, the clerk at the photographic store, the doctor. Powerful evidence that lies. Damning evidence that... That'll send Oliver Littlefield to the electric chair.
Mr. Littlefield, it's all over.
I knew it. I knew what you would find.
The coroner's jury found the testimony of the librarian, the clerk, and the rest convincing.
Undeniable.
And, of course, the presence of the glass of poison at your wife's bedside was confusing. Undoubtedly, she had intended to commit suicide. But, of course, we know now that she didn't.
When'll I be arrested?
That is a matter for the police. If they decide to prosecute, of course, under the circumstances...
Circumstances. Circumstantial evidence. I didn't murder my wife. I didn't.
Of course not, Mr. Littlefield. The autopsy settled that. Not a single trace of poison in the body. She died as a result of her illness.
No poison?
No poison, and lucky for you, Mr. Littlefield. Because if she'd committed suicide as she planned, just how would you have been able to prove your innocence, Mr. Littlefield? Just exactly how?
Suspense. Presented by Roma Wines. R-O-M-A. Made in California for enjoyment throughout the world. This is Ken Niles for Roma Wines. One more day to Labor Day weekend, the traditional occasion for tasty outdoor barbecues or picnics, and your last chance to select the delicious Grand Estate wines that can add so much pleasure and good taste to your holiday dining.
Yes, Grand Estate wines are becoming the choice of discriminating wine users everywhere. For in Grand Estate wines by Roma, you enjoy the brilliant clarity, full fragrance, and mellow taste that distinguish truly great wines. Your first sip of Grand Estate wine will convince you that in Grand Estate there is a difference. A difference born of choicest grapes and the patient, priceless skill of Roma, America's greatest vintner. So this weekend, enjoy the magnificent taste harmony of Grand Estate California Burgundy and juicy charcoal broiled steaks or grilled hamburgers. Or bring out the full flavor of chicken with glorious Grand Estate California Sauterne. Remember the name, Grand Estate Wines by Roma. Crowning achievement of vintner skill.
Hume Cronin appeared through the courtesy of Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer, producers of the Technicolor musical Holiday in Mexico. Next Thursday, same time, Roma Wines will bring you Mr. Robert Young as star of Suspense, radio's outstanding theater of thrills.
Produced by William Spear for the Roma Wine Company of Fresno, California. This is CBS, the Columbia Broadcasting System. And now, Roma Wines, R-O-M-A, made in California for enjoyment throughout the world. Roma Wines present...
Suspense. Tonight, Roma Wines bring you Mr. Robert Young as star of You'll Never See Me Again, a suspense play produced, edited, and directed for Roma Wines by William Spear.
Suspense. Radio's outstanding theater of thrills is presented for your enjoyment by Roma Wines. That's R-O-M-A, Roma Wines. Those excellent California wines that can add so much pleasantness to the way you live, to your happiness in entertaining guests, to your enjoyment of everyday meals. Yes, right now, a glass full would be very pleasant as Roma Wines bring you Robert Young in a remarkable tale of...
Suspense.
Oh, you're walking out on me.
What does it look like to you?
Like you're walking out on me? Got everything you need?
Well, at least I'm glad you're showing your true colors. I'd rather have found it out now than later.
Didn't take you long, did it, baby? If you're looking for your coat, it's in here.
Thanks.
Need any money?
I don't need anything from you, including your wedding ring. Here.
Hmm.
You know what you can do with it.
Sure, hock it. Well, pick a nice, quiet hotel.
I don't have to pick a hotel. I'm no orphan.
When you get good and sick of it, come on back and... maybe I'll still be here.
You'll still be here. You'll never see me again as long as you live.
You'll never see me again as long as you live. You'll never see me again as long as you live, she said. If I'd known then what I know now, I guess that wouldn't have sounded so funny. All right, maybe I'm not the easiest guy in the world to get along with. But it's perfectly natural for a couple to have at least one good fight after they've been married nearly 3 months. And I just wasn't going to be the first one to say uncle, that's all. Still, you don't wait around forever when your wife walks out on you, even if you are playing hard to get. So, the third evening, I put in a call. I knew all along she'd head for her mother's place. Anyway, she'd practically told me where she was going when she left.
Hello?
Oh, hello. Is this Mrs. Alden?
Yes.
This is Ed. Janet's husband.
Oh, yes. How is Janet?
Well... isn't she there with you?
With me? Why, no, isn't she with you?
No.
Her hair. Jane was busy and didn't see me come in. I coughed. Lightly.
Oh, Mr. Littlefield, good morning.
Good morning, Jane.
I heard you cough. Do you have a cold?
No. No, I haven't a cold. I never felt better in my life.
Well, I'm sorry, Mr. Littlefield.
Oh,
I just thought...
forgive me, Jane. I didn't mean to snap at you. I guess I'm a little jumpy this morning.
Well, I can understand your being jumpy. Mr. Bevins can certainly be an old bear if he finds a mistake in the books.
He certainly can.
But I wouldn't worry. You're well-dressed for the occasion. That rose in your lapel should appeal to his more pleasant side. That is, if he has a more pleasant side.
Just happened to notice the bud in one of the bushes in the garden this morning. I don't know why I wore it.
It looks very nice.
Thank you. It's a climbing talisman. You know anything about roses?
No, I'm afraid not. They're my favorite flower, though.
I grow them as a hobby. I had some exhibited once.
Oh, you must be quite a gardener.
Oh, no, I'm not really. You see, there isn't a lot to growing a good rose. You just have to watch your soil carefully. Irrigate, of course.
Uh-huh.
And roses take a lot of spraying, too.
Oh, I see.
And let me tell you, if you intend to exhibit your flowers, there mustn't be any evidence of insect damage. Mm-hmm. You see, a rose is judged first by its form and color, then substance, then...
Excuse me.
Oh, of course.
Yes, sir.
Have you seen Littlefield?
Why, yes, sir. He...
Why in the name of heaven has he come in here? Why doesn't he know he has a 9 o'clock appointment with me?
Mr. Bevins, Mr. Littlefield has been waiting for you in the outer office. You didn't call, sir,
and... Is it necessary for me to call my employees after I've made a specific appointment?
Well, I'm sorry, Mr. Bevins. I'm sure that Mr.
Littlefield's a fool. Have him come in here right away.
Yes, sir. Mr. Littlefield,
it's all right.
I just...
It's all right, Jane. I'll go right in. I walked toward the door. I could feel that lump inside of me getting bigger, almost choking. What right did Bevins have to say such things about me? And in front of Jane? I reached for the door handle and turned it.
Well, Littlefield? What are you standing there for? Come in. Sit down. Littlefield, I believe you're aware of my sentiments regarding punctuality. I expect my employees to be on time. In fact, I demand that they do.
Well, you see, Mr. Bevins...
Never mind. We'll discuss the matter at a later date. Right now, I want to see the vouchers. Last month's.
Yes, sir. Right here.
Littlefield, these are the May vouchers.
Oh. So they are. I'm sorry, Mr. Bevins. Here.
Oh. Now, let me see the audit on these.
Yes, sir.
Not the sales slips, Littlefield. The audit.
Oh.
What the devil's wrong with you, man?
What?
A person would think you are completely addled.
Addled? Well, I'm not addled. And I'm not a fool, either. You had no right to call me that, you understand?
Littlefield, I think you must be ill.
No, I'm not ill. Don't say I'm ill, because I never felt better in my life. All that's wrong with me, Mr. Bevins, is that I'm mad.
Yes, that's the word for it. I think you are mad. Completely mad.
That's not what I mean either, Mr. Bevins. I'm perfectly all right, except that I'm not going to sit here and listen to you calling me names. No, sir. I've got 17 years' worth of temper stored up right here, and I'm warning you, Mr. Bevins, I'd like to tell you just what I think of you.
Get out of this office, Littlefield. If there's one thing I will not tolerate, it's insubordination.
All right, Mr. Bevins, all right. So I'm insubordinate. And it may surprise you to know that I've wanted to be insubordinate for 17 long years.
See here, young...
17 years I've worked for you, and what thanks have I ever had for it? $2 raises, and listening to you about...
Littlefield, get out! You're fired.
I know. Sure, I'm fired. But that's all you can do to me, Mr. Bevins. All you can do is fire me. Why didn't you fire me a long time ago? So there I was. Out of a job. What was the next step? I couldn't go home in the middle of the day. Well, I could, but you don't know Laura. Never would have been able to explain it to her. She wouldn't have understood. She never understood anything. With her, it was payday, the bridge club, a new hat for Easter. Everything suburban, everything in a rut, always in a rut. Oh, I went back and sat in my office to think. After a little while, I got up and went to the water cooler, pulled my handkerchief out to wipe off my hands, and something fell out of my pocket. It was that little pill box. I opened it. There were 3.5 of those Maxedrines in it. I swallowed them all. I sat down and in a little I began to feel clear in my mind. My life with this awful, deadly grind because I was married to Laura. She was the cause of all my unhappiness. The cause of my failure, the reason for my losing my job. Something would have to be done about Laura. Why not eliminate the cause? That was it. Eliminate the cause and you have the situation licked. Eliminate the cause. Suddenly my mind was made up. I must kill Laura.
For Suspense, Roma Wines are bringing you Hume Cronin in Blue Eyes by Charles Smith and Lewis Reed. Roma Wines' presentation tonight in radio's outstanding theater of thrills, Suspense.
Between the acts of Suspense, this is Ken Niles for Roma Wines. Every great artist creates many fine paintings, but there is usually one picture in which the artist's talents combine magnificently to produce a masterpiece. It is frequently so with wines. Long famed for the excellence of Roma wines, Roma, America's greatest vintner, has created a limited bottling of outstanding character, Grand Estate Wines. Each a masterpiece of fine winemaking. Yes, Grand Estate wines by Roma possess all the qualities of wine greatness: brilliant clarity, full fragrance, and soft, rich taste. For Roma vintners, with infinite patience and age-old skill, have captured, from choicest grapes, the ultimate in wine goodness. That is why discriminating wine users everywhere recognize Grand Estate wines as the crowning achievement of vintner skill. Tomorrow, enjoy the delightful experience awaiting you in Grand Estate California wines. For gracious hospitality before dinner, serve your guests Grand Estate medium sherry. For smart afternoon or evening entertaining, delight everyone with Grand Estate ruby port or golden muscatel. Remember the name, Grand Estate Wines by Roma. Each a taste masterpiece.
And now, Roma Wines bring back to our Hollywood soundstage Hume Cronin, who as Oliver Littlefield in Blue Eyes, continues a narrative well calculated to keep you in suspense.
Murder's a tough proposition. Takes a lot of thought. Mustn't be messy or violent. It's got to be quick and effective. Or else a guy stands a chance of getting caught. How to do this thing? How to do it without a slip? Suddenly, I had it. Laura took some medicine every night at bedtime. 2 tablespoons of powder that Dr. Thacker had prescribed for her and a glass of warm milk. If I were to get some poison that looked like that powder and substitute... Yes. That was perfect. It couldn't miss. Quick and effective. Three o'clock. I walked up the steps of the public library and went in.
Yes, sir. Can I help you?
I'd like to see some books on...
Yes?
I just wanted to look over something on roses.
Oh, that's horticulture, section 5, just across the aisle.
Oh, yes, horticulture, of course. Thank you. I took a book from the shelf, thumbed a few pages, and then finally decided to risk a quick glance in the direction of the librarian, see if she was still watching me. The desk was empty. She'd left it. Then I saw where she was, at the other end of the library, stacking books in a handcar. Here was my chance. I could slip across to the science alcove without her seeing. I went to the section marked Science, Medicine. Looked in the card index file under P. Pharmacology. Here it is. Pharmacology and Therapeutics by Walter A. Bastido, Ph.G., M.D. Someday I'm going to look up those initials and find out what they mean. I found the book. The index said, look under hydrocyanate acid and cyanate. And there it was. Cyanate, used as intensifier in photographic development. 2.5 grains of this cyanate is reckoned to be a lethal dose. I could buy the stuff in a photographic store. 2.5 grains. Fatal.
Pardon me, sir.
Oh, yes?
I'd like to put these books away if I may. Oh, you're the gentleman who was looking for books on roses.
Yes, I was.
Well, I'm afraid you're in the wrong department, sir. I told you a moment ago you'll find everything on roses. Oh, it was clumsy of me. I'm terribly sorry, sir.
Oh, it's all right. It's my fault. I was in the way.
Oh, you dropped your book. Here.
Thank you.
Well, this isn't a book on roses at all. It's pharmacology.
Oh, well, what do you know about that? I must have picked up the wrong book somewhere.
Yes, you must have.
She stared at me as I put the book back on the shelf. I turned and walked away. I could feel her eyes following me through the door. I was conscious of that lump under my heart again. I felt heavy and hard like a rock. And there was a dryness in my throat, too. I swallowed a few times to get rid of it. At 4th and Sutter, there's a photographic supply place.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon. I'd like some cyanate, please.
Oh, how much do you want, sir?
Oh, enough to treat some negatives with. Quite a few negatives.
Yeah, about 2 pounds?
Yes, I think that'll be fine.
Well, I'll wait for you. What kind of camera have you been using?
What? Oh, I have a Brownie camera.
Brownie, eh? Yeah. A lot of people are going back to them since the war. You can take good pictures with a box camera if you use it right. You know what they say. It's not the camera, but the man behind the camera that makes the picture.
Yes.
What size negative do you shoot with it?
Negatives? Well, as far as negatives go,
Three and a quarter, probably. That's what most Brownies take.
Yes, that's the size. I wasn't going to be able to keep this up much longer. I was bound to make a slip sooner or later. Couldn't say I was in a hurry. He might get suspicious. A man buying poison shouldn't ever be in a hurry. Why was he taking so long? I could feel perspiration on my forehead, cold and damp. The room began to look lopsided. Everything seemed to be swaying. Grip the counter with both hands. Grip it tightly. Now smile.
Here you are, sir. That'd be 57 cents.
Yes, here.
Thank you. Just a minute. Mister.
I heard him shout after me, but I kept right on walking, faster. So a photographic studio was just like a drugstore after all. If you bought poison, you had to sign for it. Well, I wasn't going to. No, sir, I wasn't going to. I ducked around the corner.
Hey, mister.